The historic Penn Wells Hotel has welcomed visitors to Wellsboro for more than 150 years. The hotel was constructed in 1869 and opened in 1870 as the Cone House. Initially, guests were primarily engaged in commercial pursuits, staying in the hotel for short stints after arriving by rail or coach, and some taking residence at the hotel for longer periods as they worked in local industries. With its rebirth as the Penn Wells Hotel in 1926, the hotel welcomed an increasing number of leisure travelers to the area. Travelers taking advantage of the beginnings of auto travel came to take in the spacious countryside, particularly the Pine Creek Gorge, which came to be known as the Pennsylvania Grand Canyon. Today, the hotel is a member of the Historic Hotels of America, offering a well-preserved example of architecture from both its 1869 construction and its 1920s era interior finishings, as well as numerous historical items of note, such as the glass bulb American flag that adorns one wall in its elegant lobby, and the black and white photos that line the dining room walls. Benjamin Wister Morris, an agent of the Pine Creek Land Company, first came to Tioga County, Pennsylvania, from Philadelphia in 1805 with his wife, Mary Wells Morris, and their two children, Samuel and Rebecca. When they constructed their simple log cabin home, it was the only dwelling in what is now the borough of Wellsboro. Just 1 year later, with the Morrises still the only family living in the area, Wellsboro, named for Benjamin's wife, was designated as the county seat through the agency of the Pine Creek Land Company. Wellsboro's location at the intersection of the Morris State Road, Route 287, and the East and West State Road, Route 6, made it a prime thoroughfare even in the early 1800s. And so, Wellsboro's first tavern was built in 1816 on the site of the present Penn Wells Hotel, when Alphus Cheney, the first sheriff of Tioga County, purchased the land from Samuel Morris. Since the construction of that first tavern, the site has always been occupied by a tavern, inn, or hotel. Wellsboro in those early years was primarily visited by those engaged in lumber and mining activities, and drew other businessmen as a result of being the county seat of Tioga. Albert Pitkin, or A.P. Cone, was a lawyer born in New Hampshire who relocated and settled in the Oakland and Lawrenceville areas before establishing a legal practice and real estate interests in Wellsboro. In 1850, he married Anna Baich, whose deceased father, William Baich, had been one of Wellsboro's most prominent early settlers and its first merchant. Hobart Graves had operated the United States House on the site of the Penn Wells Hotel until it burned in 1866. Cone purchased the property from Graves' estate, and it was vacant until April 1869, when at the age of 49, he began his now famous construction of our hotel, a prominent landmark then and now. The builder was S.B. Brookman of Elmira, New York. On March 30th, 1870, the Wellsboro Agitator reported,
"One of the finest improvements made in Wellsboro for many years is the large four-story brick hotel erected by A.P. Cone. The French roof and the observatory above, covered in the same style, give it the finishing touch. When this structure is finished, it will be one of the largest and finest of its kind in northern Pennsylvania."
The hotel reportedly cost $50,000, with furnishings costing an additional $12,000 to $15,000. The completed house contained 77 bedrooms, as well as ground floor shops. Cone died unexpectedly in September 1872 at the age of 51 from a malarial fever contracted on a trip to North Carolina, where he had extensive business interests. After Cone's death, the hotel was sold to B.B. Holiday in 1873 and briefly went by Holiday Inn, with Mr. Holiday keeping the hotel himself, with Major Field running the dining room. The hotel was sold next to Joel Parkhurst, who renamed the hotel Parkhurst House, which was run by Thomas Vesey via lease as a landlord until 1883. On November 30, 1875, Mr. Vesey, who was new to the hotel business, took a block ad in the Agitator announcing,
"Having leased this well-known hotel, I shall open it to the public Monday, November 1st, 1875. The house has been thoroughly renovated throughout and has all the modern improvements. It is now a first-class hotel in every particular, and I feel confident ensuring its former patrons, as well as those whose health, business, or pleasure may call them to this vicinity, that no pains will be spared to make their visit an agreeable one."
In 1884, steam heat was added to the Parkhurst House, and a one-story addition provided bathrooms, a barber shop, and billiard room. The sample room and bar were relocated, and a ladies' entrance was added on Wall Street. The hotel was renamed the Coles House on April 27, 1885, when J.S. Coles purchased an interest in the Parkhurst House and took over its operation. Coles had previously operated another property under the Coles House name, but that hotel had burned. J.S. ran the hotel with the help of his brother, William Riley Coles, who took over operations in 1893 when J.S. Coles fell ill. In 1896, J.S. Coles passed away, turning the operation of the hotel over to his brother, William Riley Coles, who became full owner of the hotel and made major renovations to the hotel, including painting the hotel woodwork red, refacing the original brick, adding a steel ceiling in the dining room, placing a tin roof on the hotel's notoriously leaky roof, and opening a new bar room. During this late 1800s period, as it is today, the Coles House was a center of activity in Wellsboro, serving as the site for marriages, meetings, and events, such as the Bucktail Survivor Banquet in 1888, and the annual receptions for the Eureka Hook and Ladder Company. On a cold March morning in 1906, with temperatures reading 10 below zero, a major fire struck the hotel. W.R. Coles and his wife, who occupied the south corner room on the third floor, noticed glowing embers floating past their window. Investigating further, Coles discovered flames bursting from the ceiling near the cupola. He extinguished that blaze with a pitcher of water and thought the situation under control. However, he discovered more flames near the main chimney at the south corner of the hotel. Other citizens walking by the hotel noticed the mansard roof ablaze and tried to raise the alarm, but 20 minutes passed before the electric company's powerhouse could be notified to blow the siren whistle. When the response arrived, water pressure was initially low, and the freezing conditions left only two hydrants available to fight the blaze. At 6:15 a.m., the cupola collapsed, followed by the roof at 6:45. The fire did not come under control until 8:30 on that morning. No guests were injured due to the containment of the fire to the third and fourth floor, but those two stories were gutted by the fire, and the top floor had to be removed. The April 4th, 1906 Agitator reported that it sold more than 1,000 postcards showing the Coles House an hour after the fire was extinguished. The Coles and staff and a few displaced boarders tented in the old campground while repairs were made. A large tent was spread over the Coles House walls to protect from storms. The kitchen and dining rooms only suffered water damage, so were able to be used to cook meals for the family. Coles continued to operate the three-story Penn Wells Hotel for an additional 14 years. The last few confined to the hotel with Bright's disease, until his death in 1920 left the hotel with an uncertain future. Born in 1850, Leonard Harrison experienced these early years of the hotel firsthand. Harrison worked as a clerk in the Tioga County Commissioner's Office, where he became familiar with land in the county. From there, he went into the lumber and coal businesses, founding Tioga Lumber Company, and enjoying great success. He became a civic leader, heading the Wellsboro Electric Company, the First National Bank of Wellsboro, and numerous other positions of public import. In 1906, he bought the land now known as Leonard Harrison Park, developed the site, and invited the public to come enjoy the scenic views of the Pine Creek Gorge. In the final years of his life, he would go on to become instrumental to the rebirth of the Penn Wells Hotel. Near the turn of the century, another notable figure arrived in Wellsboro. Roy J. Dunham and his wife Fanny moved into Wellsboro from a farm just east of Wellsboro. Dunham entered the merchant trade, entering into a partnership that would become Dunham's Department Store. Dunham, his son Frank, and his three sons, James, John, and Robert, would play a significant role in the survival of the Penn Wells. In 1921, Clark B. Richardson, a Galton hotelier, purchased the Coles House property from the estate of William Riley Coles, with financial backing from Leonard Harrison, Horace Packer, and other local business leaders. He changed the name of the property to the Wellsboro Inn. Richardson intended to make major improvements and refurbishments, but that did not come to pass. The Wellsboro Inn closed on October 23, 1925, and on October 26th through the 28th, an auction sale was held to dispose of all Wellsboro Inn furniture, including cigar cases, barroom fixtures, and furniture. In response to the declining success of the Wellsboro Inn, on May 1, 1925, in a meeting held at Tioga Country Club, the Wellsboro Hotel Company was formed to purchase the property. Notable figures at the meeting included Leonard Harrison, who would personally buy 1/6 of the subscription of shares and bonds issued to support the hotel's renewal, Roy Dunham, former Congressman Horace Packer, and Claude E. Bennett, president of Tioga Savings and Trust, who would serve as the first Wellsboro Hotel Company president. What followed was a complete renovation of the hotel, which would be renamed the Penn Wells Hotel. While the walls, floors, and some partitions were kept, most of the Penn Wells was new. New floors were laid on top of the old floors. A new water system with brass pipe was added with a thermocirculation system that at that time was considered state-of-the-art for its ability to keep hot water present throughout the building. A heating system of steam air was installed. Upon completion, Albert Carhan, inspector for the State Department of Labor and Industry, was quoted as saying,
"No city of 50,000 people has any better hotel than the Penn Wells. The appointments, furnishings, and equipment throughout are the best and compare with most modern hotels in the biggest cities."
The reconstructed Penn Wells contained 55 guest rooms, 42 containing private baths, as well as two public baths, one on each of the guest room floors. The bathrooms included tile wainscoting and ventilating air shafts leading up to the roof. The hotel included an electric Otis elevator, the same one present in the Penn Wells Hotel to this day. The new kitchen was also state-of-the-art, including an electric baker's oven, electric broiler, electric dishwasher, steam table, coal range, and modern refrigeration system, including cookers and ice cream cabinet in the kitchen, and cooling boxes in the basement. The heart of the L-shaped lobby was the large fireplace, built of masonry brick with terracotta tile flooring, above which hung the E.M. Shumway photograph of the canyon, taken from Harrison Lookout and gifted to the hotel by Leonard Harrison himself. Mr. Harrison also donated the cost of the plaster and hotel lobby floor tile. The interior lobby trim was finished in Philippine mahogany. The exterior was stuccoed and painted cream with brown trimmings, with a marble vestibule at the hotel entrance. Also notable, given the hotel's history, was the modern sprinkler system and fire escapes, as well as the existence of telephones in every room in the house. Former Congressman and board member Horace Packer was given credit for the new name, Penn Wells. The Philadelphia Inquirer reported,
realizing the necessity of a first-class hotel, 60 enterprising men and women residents subscribed the funds to build and equip it. One of the leading hotel architects in the state was employed. Not only has money with lavish hand been expended to make it notable, but talented men and women of the community of large experience and keen artistic sense and taste have bent their energies to make it more than an inn, but a community center of pardonable pride, which can but result in giving it an atmosphere, which means more than shelter and entertainment and its spotless town environment. Architecturally and with artistic appointments, with its 55 rooms, single and ensuite, 42 with built-in bath and showers and many in addition, it is a hotel gem of the Roosevelt Highway.
Paul Hilbert, an experienced restaurateur in Rochester and New York, moved from East Orange, New Jersey to manage the Penn Wells upon reopening. He had also managed the Sagerstown Mineral Springs Hotel in Sistersville, West Virginia. With Hilbert at the helm, the Penn Wells reopened to guests on July 28, 1926. L. Meyer of New York and Rutherford, New Jersey, was the first guest registered at the Penn Wells reopening. Mr. Meyer told the local paper,
I had a delightful sleep last night in one of the quietest and most restful hotels I have ever visited. There are 100,000 people who travel between New York, Buffalo, and points west every week, some of whom will get the benefit of this delightful midway stopping place. Not only the Penn Wells Hotel, but the beautiful country a tourist would see by coming this way and stopping in Wellsboro. I wish also to commend the people of Wellsboro who had the vision, public spirit, and enterprise to provide such an excellent hotel. They deserve unlimited praise for providing a hotel that will before long be known from coast to coast as one of the best hotels in the country.
20 rooms in the Penn Wells were occupied that initial night by guests hailing from Waynesboro, Pennsylvania, Buffalo, Rochester, Ashtabula, Ohio, East Orange, New Jersey, Williamsport, Hammondsport, Pottsville, White Plains, New York, Elmira, St. Mary's, Pennsylvania, and St. Louis, Missouri. The new Penn Wells found immediate success.
Wellsboro's now famous Penn Wells Hotel, an important stopover resort on the Roosevelt Highway, is in the throes of one of the most unprecedented tourist rushes this season. The fame of the Penn Wells has spread rapidly through the results of visits of tourists early in the summer, and for three consecutive nights this week, many guests were turned away because of the crowded conditions of the hotel. Much of the rush is due to the publicity campaign being conducted through the cooperation of the Cleveland Automobile Club and the New York City Automobile Club. The Roosevelt Trail, shorter by 90 miles than any other east-west New York to Chicago route, is being boosted tremendously through the efforts of the Cleveland Club, especially. Wellsboro is just a day's drive from Cleveland, and the majority of eastbound tourists make the Penn Wells their stopping place.
Not resting with the huge renovation completed in 1926, in 1927, construction began on a fourth story with 32 additional guest rooms to bring the hotel back to its original height. All woodwork on the new top floor, which was completed in 1928, was solid mahogany. The modern hotel's footprint was completed with an addition finished in November 1931. Adding 18 guest rooms and expanded the dining room, making it fit for parties of up to 250 people. The present-day lounge was created from the assembly room that then existed in that space. That same year, George Mather's Beauty Shop was converted into a vanity room for the hotel women's lobby bathroom, and a Western Union office was opened in the hotel. In March 1932, the neon sign reading Penn Wells Hotel was added to the roof. Manager Paul Hilbert said it would be visible.
From the top of the hill as Route 6 enters Wellsboro, as well as from the Tioga Street corner where the same route comes in from the west.
During this period, the Penn Wells was visited by many celebrities traveling the east-west route, including Groucho Marx in 1928.
As the summer tourist season approaches, noteworthy names are beginning to make their appearance on the registry of the Penn Wells, and among the first to be listed this year was the name of Julius Marx, known to the stage and screen as Groucho, one of the four Marx brothers, his lawyer and party. The Marx Group stopped at the Penn Wells Sunday night on their way to New York City, where arrangements for a new movie starring the Marx Brothers will be completed. In the party were Julius Marx, Herman Leventhal, Frank Hill, and Mrs. N.E. Carpenter. They traveled in a Ford sedan and a Cadillac. They left early Monday morning.
In 1930, the Penn Wells was visited by writer Hugh Fullerton, the famous sports writer who uncovered the 1919 Chicago Black Sox scandal. He said, "I've stopped at perhaps 5,000 hotels in all sections of the country and found few better managed, with better service, or more cordiality than the Penn Wells at Wellsboro affords." He returned in 1932 for a visit of local points of interest. In 1935, the Penn Wells was visited by the famous Siamese twins and their wives, where they attended the Arcadia while traveling from New York to Chicago. Actress Joan Crawford stayed at the Penn Wells in 1943, and her photo is among the collection in the existing Penn Wells dining room. After 10 successful years, Mr. Hilbert retired and was succeeded by Faye Van Horn, who had been employed by Hotel Edison and Delmonico's in New York City. Hugh Dale, who began at the hotel for its 1926 reopening, was promoted to assistant manager and would be a leading figure at the hotel until his retirement as manager in the 1960s, at which time he still continued as a member of the board of directors. Wellsboro's emergence as a destination for tourists began immediately following the Penn Wells reopening in 1926. But it took on a new significance in the late 1930s, when local businessman Larry Wooden decided to counter the economic downturn by the promoting of the Pennsylvania Grand Canyon as an attraction for tourists. 1937 saw the first chartered bus excursion to the canyon, bringing a party of 28 sightseers from Baltimore, led by Monumental Motor Tours of Baltimore. That year, the Wellsboro Gazette described the hotel as thronged by all the fall foliage visitors following the chamber's initial foliage promotion efforts. The B&O Railroad ran excursions from Pittsburgh that fall. 250 people rode the train to Gailton, where they were provided cars to visit the canyon. Local papers noted that the Penn Wells was filled with people driving in from the east to see the canyon. 1937 also saw the inaugural Pennsylvania State Laurel Festival held in Wellsboro. The festival was again the brainchild of Larry Wooden as a way to draw attention to the Pennsylvania Grand Canyon and the natural beauty in Wellsboro and the surrounding areas, as signified by the blooming of the mountain laurel, Pennsylvania state flower. Organized initially by the Wellsboro Lions Club, the festival added a pageant of Laurel Queens following the war, and the headquarters for the pageant activities was naturally the Penn Wells. On July 1, 1942, an observation post was started on the Penn Wells roof, replacing the Smith Post near the Tioga Country Club. Claude Bennett was appointed by Brigadier General John K. Cannon, U.S. Army, as the chief observer, and Hugh Dale, Larry Wooden, and Mrs. M.A. Kinch were appointed assistant chief observers. The Army noted Wellsboro's location directly between New York City and America's industrial centers. Women were charged with daytime watches, while men took the night shift for this 24-hour observation operation. Our glass bulb American flag made its first appearance in the hotel in 1946. That year, the local Corning glass plant decided to do something special to honor those who had returned from the war. Design engineer Ellsworth C. Brown, a returning veteran himself, drew the blueprints. Plant manager D.J. Carr made two requests of Brown.
"Design something patriotic and something that really represents our plant."
Wellsboro's Corning plant had taken on a new role as producer of glass Christmas bulbs during the war in order to replace supply that had previously been imported from Germany and Japan. Notably, Max Eckerd contracted the Wellsboro plant to provide bulbs for the shiny bright ornaments he sold out of New York City. In 1946, Wellsboro's plant was the largest manufacturer of Christmas tree ornaments in the world. So an American flag made of glass bulb ornaments was a natural fit. The carpentry department then constructed the flag to be placed behind the head table as a one-of-a-kind backdrop in the Penn Wells Hotel dining room for the CGW's annual service banquet, which was held in December of that year. The flag traveled to Corning headquarters and was displayed by Max Eckerd at the Crest 5 and Dime on Fifth Avenue in New York City. It was featured in a Patriotism in America spread in the July 4, 1960 issue of Life magazine. After returning to the Penn Wells, it found a permanent home in the main lobby. Since 1925, the Penn Wells has been maintained as a community-owned hotel. The Dunham family has had a particularly strong relationship to the hotel over that period. Best known for founding Dunham's department store, Roy J. Dunham was one of the original directors when the Wellsboro Hotel Company was formed in 1925. And his son Frank also served on the hotel company board for many years, including as president. They felt maintaining the hotel was instrumental to the success of Wellsboro's Main Street and the department store. Frank felt the same about the Arcadia Theater, which he bought and operated. The Arcadia would also become part of the Wellsboro Hotel Company. Frank and his sons would play a large role in the development of the Penn Wells Lodge, originally called the Penn Wells Motel. This Penn Wells project was aimed at the changing needs of car travelers at that time. Through multiple expansions over generations, the Penn Wells Lodge is now an 89-room hotel serving as the sister property to the historic hotel. The modern Penn Wells is an active hotel welcoming lodging visitors from April through December and for special winter weekends each year, and restaurant patrons year-round. The current board and management of the hotel are committed to historic preservation of the property, including restoration of the brick exterior, maintenance and restoration of the interior architectural features, as well as continuing to update mechanical features of the building while keeping the historic ambiance. With these and other advancements, we will provide guests a rich experience in our historic building with the expected comfort, style, and service, so guests can enjoy everything Wellsboro and the surrounding area have to offer. The modern hotel's visitors travel to work, shop, and engage with the great outdoors while they experience the living history that is the modern Penn Wells Hotel.